Hello everybody. I'd like to welcome you to another of our nice ABI seminars. Today it's a pleasure to me to introduce Professor Gerald Gerlach from the University in Dresden in Germany. He was my PhD supervisor when I did my PhD at his Institute for Solid State Electronics. And he is specialized in the field of sensing and micromechanical and electronics. Yes, so all that microstructured silicon technologies. And he gives us an insight in his very interesting research he's doing at his institute regarding hydrogel-based chemical and biochemical sensors. And I'm pretty sure a lot of you will be quite interested in what you can do with hydrogels, and perhaps you will find some ideas here how to perhaps use hydrogels in your own research. So thank you for coming today, and
thank you very much. Thank you for joining this talk. It's a great pleasure for me to be here and to see what's going on, the very, very interesting projects. As Markus told, I'm from Germany, so it's the opposite side of the globe. And here just the map, Germany, and this is where Dresden is located, Technical University in Dresden. And Dresden is a very nice city. So I have seen that Auckland is a very, very beautiful city, but Dresden as well. And you are invited to come to Dresden. You can see Dresden is city of Baroque and sandstone. And this is center of the city. There is the so-called Dresden Zwinger. Here is the Royal Saxonian Palace. It's located at the river of Elbe, which flows towards Hamburg. And there is the cathedral. There's the so-called Our Lady's Church, which was totally destroyed after World War II and was reconstructed in the last 20 years, and just by funding by peoples, by foundations and so on. So more or less without governmental funding. So very, very beautiful city. With a very old technical university founded in 1828, became Royal Saxonian Polytechnical School in 1871, University of Technology in 1961. You have almost 37 or 38,000 students. But the history in engineering is a little bit older, because it was the first German engineering academy which was established in 1743, at that time as part of the military. So there is civil engineering, and there was engineering for military purposes. Was the very first engineering school in Germany. So it was dominated at that time by the French, and then was the first time that in Germany these activities were established. So this is the city. So there somewhere is the river, and in this house of Dresden, here you can see is the campus, the main campus. But here is a construction site. In the meanwhile, there are a lot of buildings for technology, for microelectronics, and there's also the site where our newly built technology building was opened 3 years ago. Couple of words to our department, the Electrical Computer Engineering Department, with 29 full professors, two junior professors, which means assistant professors, or similar to assistant professors, more than 2,300 students and 420 PhD students at a department. And six main research fields: automation, measurement control, communications, electrical power engineering, electromechanical and biomedical systems, information electronics, and our lab belongs to micro opto nano electronics. So Dresden is the capital of microelectronics in Europe. That means more than 30,000 people are employed in microelectronics industry. There's Global Foundries, there is Infineon, and there are many, many small companies in this field, and solid state electronics in this case. What our lab is here belongs by the educational programs to microelectronics. In our case, solid state electronics means more or less solid state sensors, thin films for certain functionalities. This is so a little bit, or these are the fields we are involved in. So the roots are in infrared sensors in systems. 45 years ago, when the lab was established, was with the purpose for non-destructive evaluation of electronic devices by means of infrared radiation, because infrared sensors were used mainly for military purposes. There was the goal to establish an infrared sensor system industry in East Germany at that time, with development of materials, certain technologies, and then to use it for pyrometry, for thermal imaging, and also for gas analysis and presence detectors. Then there is the field of MEMS sensors using the piezoresistive effect. So there is also materials technology. And the applications for different fields, this is what I will speak about in the next 30 minutes. Then we deal with ultrasonic sensors for non-destructive testing, medical diagnostics and other fields, and functional thin films for ferroelectric devices, electrocaloric devices. So that means for cooling, different from thermoelectric cooling, which means where the change in the texture of these ferroelectric fields is used for large energy changes by very small temperature changes. So, and then absorption and emission of infrared radiation, which belongs a little bit to this field. So topic of my talk today are hydrogels for chemical, biochemical sensors. So what are hydrogels? You know, the jelly bears. So if you put the jelly bears into water, what happens? They start to swell. Takes certain time and they become thicker and thicker, and the volume is increased. And this is what a real hydrogel is a macromolecule, a polymer, cross-linked, cannot be solved in water. That means it stays, but it can swell. There is huge water take-up, and the volume in the swollen state is the volume of the polymer plus the volume of the water which was taken up. So that means you can take certain polymers, certain hydrogels, can tailor it to a certain chemical species where the swelling will take place. Could be the concentration of chemical species, like the pH value, can also be the temperature. I will show glucose concentration and other measurements. So, and you can tailor it that it will swell with the concentration, or that it de-swell, or it will swell here in this case. And this, for instance, is a pH sensitive hydrogel in pH 1 and in pH 11. Then you can imagine the amount of swelling they are able to do. So, advantages. It's reversible. That means you can use it as sensors as well as actuators. So this is great opportunity to create microsystems, including both sensors and actuators. So the energy density is quite high. So the comparable to piezoelectric materials, comparable to what is the alloys?
Shape memory
alloys. So that means if you need a certain amount of energy and the energy density is high, you can make it very, very small. So means you can use it as a MEMS device. So, and if there is a sensitivity to more than one quantity, then you can use it also as a controlled switch. So a lot of advantages. We started to think about what can we do after our colleagues from chemistry asked us. We have the hydrogels, we can pattern them by photolithography. So that means we can integrate them in very, very small devices. Are there possibilities to use it for technical devices? So this is one of the results a couple of years ago when we wrote the first experiences which we have collected with hydrogel sensors and actuators at that time. 4 years or 3.5 years, we got funding from the DFG, German Research Foundation, which funds so-called research training groups. This is funding for PhD students. In our case, we are a group of 7 professors and get funding for 13 PhD students for 4.5 years now, and we hope that we get funding for additional 4.5 years. This is the group of PhD students from the first generation. In any case, when we start with a new generation of PhD students, then we go 1 week for sailing, because it's hard to go there to the sailing boat, but then it's hard to escape. And the students have to work close together, because without working as a team, the boat will not move and the students will starve. So very, very simple, brings, melts the students very tightly together. So basic idea for what could be done with this hydrogel. When the hydrogel will swell, this creates an osmotic pressure, a swelling pressure. And the pressure can be used just by simple pressure sensors to be detected. So, and very old MEMS technology, piezo-resistive pressure sensors, very small, 1 to 5 millimeters, one size, with a flexure plate here, and there is the cavity. You can bring in the hydrogel, there are resistors, and if there is the pressure in pressure sensors, this will lead to a mechanical stress, mechanical strain in these resistors by the piezoresistive effect. It will change the resistance, and by using a Wheatstone bridge, for instance, this will give you an electrical output voltage proportional to the initial pressure here. And the only thing you have to add is to use a chemomechanical transducer, and the hydrogel is such a transducer which transforms the swelling to the pressure to be measured with the sensor element here. So just two examples for such hydrogels, very simple hydrogels. Also the procedure to synthesize these hydrogels is very easy, so we can do it without chemists in our own labs. So just as electrical engineers, this is the PVA, PAA hydrogel, where the P polyacrylic acid is the sensitive swelling component, and this leads typically to such a curve in the relationship between the output voltage and the pH value here. And the other one, the so-called NIPAM or polyNIPAM, is a temperature sensitive hydrogel. It's if you tailor it somehow, it can also be sensitive to pH, but other examples of the polyNIPAM are just sensitive to the temperature. So two ways to build such sensors. You can see here, first case, there is the volume swelling, which deflects the thin membrane here. In the other case, there is a small or a thin film covered here on the backside of this flexure plate by a bimorph effect leading to the bending there. Both have advantages and disadvantages, both solutions. So this sum of advantages, disadvantages is always constant. Here in this case, there is this volume with the high energy, means it's very, very sensitive. This is the good news. Bad news is the chemical solution has to travel long ways to fill the entire volume. This takes time. So this is sensitive, but not that really fast. Here, sensitivity by the bimorphic effect is less than for the volume effect, but it takes much less time because the thickness here is much smaller. So in general, advantages, if we have electronic parts on one side of the silicon die, we have a good separation between electronics and the chemical part of the sensor. The resistive principle is very easy for signal processing. It's cheap, you can miniaturize it. So, but there are bad news, because hydrogels, like the electroactive polymers, not just elastic materials, but viscoelastic materials. Viscoelastic materials means there is something changing by time. So in particular, if you have the ion sensitive polymers like the pH sensitive PVA, PAA hydrogels, this leads to relaxation processes due to this viscose behavior. And also the other disadvantage is what you can see here. The time constant is 100 minutes, hours. For practical applications, of course, not the best case. So what we need for technical applications is high selectivity, good long-term stability, and a fast response to the measurement. So just by considering conventional sensors, as I have shown it, there is the hydrogel, the analyte solution penetrating the hydrogel, creating the swelling pressure, and the swelling pressure leads to the swelling, and just by the measurement of the deflection, you have the proportional output voltage of the element. So this is by the hydrogel, and here the piezoresistive sensor. And the time to travel for the solution depends on the square of this size, the time constant. So needs that long time. Time can be reduced if porous hydrogels will be used. That means the pores are better measured that the fluid can travel to the hydrogel. So can do it by different approaches, like here, like a foam, or by including clay particles, for instance. We have shown that we can reduce here just by such a structure. If this is the non-porous hydrogel and here the porous hydrogel, and by comparing the time scale, you can see it's just 50%. So twice as effective, twice as fast by this. So we will get funding for another approach by using microemulsions as a template for such porous hydrogels. And the hope is that there is an additional reduction in the time constant. So other way, what we are doing is so-called force compensation, which usually is used for precision scales. If you consider precision scales, the better ones have accuracy of 10 to minus 7, which is very huge. And the same principle we try to apply here for our devices. And you can see the same. There is the volume of the hydrogel, the solution trying to penetrate the hydrogel will again lead to the swelling pressure, and then it starts to swell. This swelling is detected and measured, and we bring it to an actuator, and the actuator applies a counter pressure and brings the swelling back to the initial volume. So that means there is, at the end, no volume swelling, and by that, no penetration of the solution into the hydrogel, and all these ugly effects are gone, more or less. So considering this, there is the hydrogel, there is the piezoresistive sensor, and the output voltage is used for an actuator, which creates the counter pressure. Looks like a control loop in control theory. The difference is output voltage now will be zero, cannot be longer used as the measurement signal, but measurement signal can be used here by the counter pressure. By considering the open loop version gives the typical low band behavior of such devices, and by considering the closed loop behavior is like the in control theory is very similar, and you see that the sensor and the actuator by an amplifier, and if the amplification of the closed loop is high enough, much larger than unity, this will give minus unity. So that means the counter pressure is the opposite as the acting pressure here. And it's then always similar. So these are the only two equations I will bring during my talk, just to avoid that you will be worried what will come next. So first step was just by using a pressure source to apply this counter pressure. And this is the very first, or this was the results we achieved. The output voltage, of course, there is the detection that something is happening, and then the control loop comes in action and brings it back to zero. And the counter pressure is shown here, and you can see there is small overshoot, and then there is a constant value of this counter pressure. It becomes interesting if you compare it to the black curve here for a conventional open loop sensor, and then you can see here the time constant of hours and here time constant of minutes. So much, much better. So this approach we could show works quite well. There is the response time here, almost a little bit more than a minute, and here the very, very long response time for the open loop operation mode. So next step was second PhD thesis to make it smaller, because the pressure source is a huge device and we would like to get it small. So and the idea was, if hydrogels have the high energy density, we use the hydrogel as the actuator, and for the pH sensor, we are very much interested in pH sensing, because all the people we work together in process control are very, very much interested in having pH sensor for the long term application in line in the process, which usually is a tough job. And so we tried to apply the hydrogel, thermally sensitive hydrogel, here as the thermal actuator. So looks a little bit complicated. Also the cross section of the setup here works well, but not as simple as we believe it should. And PhD thesis is almost finished. Gave good results, not as good results as we had reached with the huge device with the pressure source. And fabrication is quite complicated, because you have to have many components here to bring it together, to assemble it, make the packaging, and so on. So and the next idea now was just to avoid this second part and to make this hydrogel both the sensor and the actuator. And that means to make it pH sensitive and temperature sensitive. And this can be done by so-called interpenetrating networks. That means is an interaction of two networks in one volume. One network, one polymer, is temperature sensitive, and the other one is pH sensitive. So this is where the colleagues from chemistry did to realize it. So this is not my field of expertise. This is what I'm interested in. There is the degree of swelling, Here not for decays of pH, but for simple salt concentration, logarithmic scale, and here is the temperature sensitivity, and you can see that you can keep a constant volume here using this line. So both for changing salt concentration by applying then the corresponding temperature to keep the volume constant. So, title of my talk was not just chemical sensors, but also biochemical sensors. We did some work in the field, in particular for glucose sensing. This was a is still an ongoing cooperation with a group of Florian Solzbacher, University of Utah, for glucose sensing for diabetes treatment. And what you have to have is, of course, the measurement of glucose concentration, but the more information you have, the better you control it. And there is the glucose, there is pH value and ion strength at least, plus temperature. And by having all together, then you can do it better. And this is the reason why it's not just one single sensor, but a sensor array with four different types of such hydrogels. And each of the hydrogels in particular tailored to the particular measurement. So for chemists, it's quite easy then to tailor glucose sensitive groups by boronic acid. So you can use the same setup, for instance, like here, CO2 sensor is another possibility using the the severing house principle. So that means if the CO2 diffuses into this reservoir, it creates a carbonate, and the carbonate will create H plus ions, which can travel through this porous membrane here and will change the pH here. So that means it's a pH sensor used by the severing house principle for the measurement of CO2. So question, of course, is to make it an implantable device and also to use silicon sensor elements directly in liquids, because possibly you know that water and humidity is not the best you can do for silicon elements. Then you have, of course, to protect the elements, and you have to make it biocompatible. Here, just to show you the glucose sensitivity and the output voltage, so it's sensitive enough by using this particular case. We tried together with a group at the University of Alabama in Huntsville to have a better encapsulation. And the technical problem is what you need is somehow a thin film which is hydrophobic to the technical side and hydrophilic to the biological side. So that means an amphilic block copolymer can serve for both requirements together with a barrier layer where the perylene C is used in many cases, gives a very, very attractive encapsulation technology which really works for the long-term perspective. So here is just the procedure, how to get it. Plasma activation, adhesion promoter, and then the as for the perylenes here, and then the deposition of these particular polymers. So we can do it for many, many other cases for biological sensing just by adding the corresponding enzymes into the hydrogel and then to bring it in the cavity. And together with the packaging, you can use it as an implantable sensor, as a sensor you can bring directly in fluids, in a fluidic environment, or as a flexible sensor, whatever you are interested in. Another idea is also to use hydrogels, the swelling behavior, for switches. And for control in households, in house installations, more than 50% of the sensors are not real sensors with an analog output signal, but just sensor switches. So for instance, in the shower, you have to switch on and to switch off a fan, for instance, if the humidity exceeds a certain threshold. So, and the question was, can we realize such sensor switches without energy? That means we take the switching energy, the energy to switch the sensor switch just by the humidity. And there is the similar approach. There is the flexure plate here and the hydrogel, which will lead to the bending of the flexure plate by increasing humidity. There are the both contacts, of course, to be closed at a certain threshold. What you have to have, this is a little bit the problem we are working at the moment on, is you have buckling for very, very fast switching. You don't need the analog deflection, but the accidental deflection if a certain threshold is reached. So this is the very first prototype together with a small company in Germany in Erfurt and other technical university in Darmstadt in Germany. The company provided the sensor elements and Darmstadt University provided the contacts. They used forests of gold nanowires on the contact areas for good contact behavior. So, okay, time is flying. Last example. This is can be used also with hydrogels, but can be also done on other principles. The question was by people from our university hospital, the monitoring of wounds, or in particular, the monitoring of inflammation of wounds, because then you have to change the bandage. And the idea should be, of course, biocompatible. Usually, you get better results when you will measure more than one measurement. There is, of course, temperature, there is pH, there is lactate responsible for inflammation, and there are the so-called nets. I will come back just in a minute. And the approach was to use impedance spectroscopy, because in the dielectric spectrum, the different elements take place at different frequencies, depending on the dielectric polarization processes behind the biological processes going on there. So, and by knowing what's going on, the main process is that when inflammation in the wound occurs, so-called neutral extracellular traps will emerge, will grow, and this can be measured very, very well by impedance spectroscopy. And this is to see in here. There is the time, this scale, there is the frequency here. There are particular frequencies for this process when inflammation occurs here in this case. I lost somehow the last picture where we tried. There is still an ongoing project to do it together with the Institute for Textile Research, to do it as a very small thread, which you can easily integrate into a textile-based bandage with a metallic core with hydrogel as a sensitive layer. And the second electrode on the outside of this thread, which gives the dielectric sensor thread, which can be knitted and whatever for the textile-based element. So, could tell you many, many other things. Possibly I should stop here, should come to the conclusions. So, hydrogels and microsystems engineering. This was the discussion we had a little bit, so I did imagine that this is a very, very important point. So what we, of course, could show the proof of all these effects. So this usually is the first PhD thesis. Of the first PhD students, then we can see there are real problems different from the problems we sort, which are ruling the devices. These real problems have to be solved, and then we can transfer this knowledge to real devices to be commercialized. So we are, this is four thesis theory. It takes at least four thesis to bring it to this end. And we are somewhere where we try to find out what the real problems are and to solve the real problems. So, and I was really surprised when I 2 years ago saw this slide. Was a talk from a company, Yole, the French-based company. For business consulting, a company, and they just showed here in this picture how long it takes from the first idea to mass production. And here is for pressure sensors, where many, many pressure sensors are used in a car. So the next were 25 years. Here, accelerometers, almost 20 years. Gyroscopes, 18 years. The microphones, silicon-based microphones for smartphones, 16 years. Oscillators, 70 years. So that means it really takes this time. And if you have applied for a patent at the beginning, then at the end, the patent is gone. You cannot earn money from the initial idea. So this is the bad news. So sorry for that. So this was so little bit the conclusion from my own experience working in the sensor field for many, many years. So I have to thank many, many people in our lab, and I told we are doing a lot of work in the infrared sensor and system field. So you can possibly estimate who am I. That's me here. That's me. So many other PhD students, I have to thank them all because they are doing the work what I did sell to you in this talk. Thank you for coming here and for being interested in the matter.
Yeah, thank you for the very interesting presentation. And if anybody of you has...
I'm just curious, is the measurement of lactate in wound healing as an indicator of anoxia and perhaps onset of gangrene, or why lactate?
I don't know. This is what the people from medicine came to us and told us. Lactate is also an important issue for inflammation processes. And if you have the knowledge, of course, this net production is the core process. This was the reason we concentrated on that, but also the pH and temperature and lactate is what's connected to this process, and they try to measure, and our colleagues from chemistry just tailored hydrogels for becoming sensitive to the lactate.
What about glucose? How can you, is there some way of determining externally what our glucose level is using hydrogels?
So at the moment, this is artificial glucose solution where we apply it directly in the fluid. The next step, possibly to try to use it extracorporeal, in an extracorporeal way, might be one of the next steps. So at the moment, we focused a little bit on to make an implantable device and to solve the problems connected to implantation, to make it biocompatible and long-term stable and so on for the packaging.
Thanks for the interesting talk. One of the ways in which you can increase the sensitivity, as you mentioned, is to take advantage of the volume increase, but perhaps constrain it in certain dimensions so that you can get preferential movement in a particular direction. But the trouble with constraints is that you're now limiting the accessibility of the stuff that you want to measure. It might be the ions, for instance. It's okay with temperature, but if you need something to perfuse into the hydrogel, have you been thinking about how you can create a sort of a stiff but porous membrane that can satisfy both of those?
There is just by going back. For instance, here, or better here, what you can use is very, very porous, layers from alumina, where you can create well-defined porosity. So, and this is very stiff with compared to the silicon membrane, much less, much higher stiffness. So this is 20 times or 50 times more stiff than the silicon membrane. So this is one of the, because you have to direct the movement in the certain direction there. And the other part, of course, has to be able to let the solvent penetrate or to at least interact with the hydrogel there. That's right. But this is given, you can buy these membranes. You posit there are different approaches. The aluminum oxide, there are techniques to make this well-defined pores in one direction. You can buy it, you can use other materials, polymer materials, cigar polymer materials, when you use bombardment of heavy ions and etch these, holes or so from the interaction of the heavy ions, then you
so
can get
enough it. So that the gel
exactly, and then you can also tailor the size of the pores to more or less the chemical species or ions or whatever you are interested to make it the right way.
Thanks very much for your talk. Very interesting. How you mentioned right at the start that. Electrical engineers can build these sensors without having to know too much about the chemistry. But how much of the challenge ahead of you do you think is related to the chemistry of these different polymers and making them specific to various measurands of interest?
50%. Yeah. So we are in. When I told about when I came in contact the first time with chemists, then the chemists were the dominating part, because this is of course what you have to have, the availability of particular hydrogels to get it used. So the first book we wrote was, the other guy was from chemistry and then the electrical engineering side. The research training group for the PhD students, what I did speak about, there are two people from chemistry, four from electrical engineering, and one who knows both sides. So this is a good combination, and we do not speak the same language, but at least we can understand what the other is speaking about. So, which is a huge fortune.
Yeah. Well, what is the, how old are the foundation patents in this area now?
We have a couple of patents.
What are the oldest ones?
The oldest one is from 2003.
Okay, so it's starting to look like they're running out of time.
This is it's becoming more expensive to keep them. Yeah, the university is supporting to hold the patents, but.
But it's a natural phenomenon that it just takes 20 years of. For to finally get commercial.
At least in the case of, for sensors, this is the field I know. And for the sensors, they're just the requirements you have to measure with an accuracy of 1% or less than 1% under all environmental conditions which are allowed, and over 10 years or more. So, and this is a huge requirement. So, in there, for that reason, you don't have to know the basic effect, but all these hidden effects which might influence sensitivity, long-term stability. So, the three big S: sensitivity, selectivity, and stability.
I was told by Renaud that we have to be out here at 5 because there's a lecture. But who has some more questions, we take that nice food and drinks trolley and just go to the next room and can discuss a little bit further.
I'm here still Friday, till Friday. So
yeah.
There is, if there is still questions. So.